Welcome, Laval!
We're at the palace right now, and I'm with Charles Lafortune, who's the host of La Voix. He's also an actor, a TV show host, and a radio show host.
I'm not anymore a radio show host, but I'm a TV producer now. I produce the series Cal and Max, which is on TVA right now, and I produce all sorts of things. Especially since I'm the parent of a 15-year-old autistic adolescent now. I was now 6'3" and wears 16 size shoes. So yeah, my life is pretty I'm pretty occupied now, I guess. My son goes to a fabulous school called Giant Steps. He's been there since he's, I think, like 3 and a half. And now he's 15. So this environment is kind of, it is a controlled environment where he has his peers, where teachers know him, where everything is really put into place to maximize, to make him succeed. And they know him. And to know that eventually he will be out of the school system. And basically, it's like the... La DPJ. I mean, when you get out of the school system, you go back to your parents, you go back to home, and a lot of times they sit at home and they don't do much. So it's the responsibility of parents to try and have them work to find activities that are motivating and that will help them still be growing. And it's better to have a successful autistic life than to fail in a neurotypical life. I thank the city of Laval to have this consciousness about people with living with the autism spectrum. People, maybe a lot of people don't know, but Laval is the first city in Quebec. We implanted a program where the police force, where the firemen know that. In fact, there's a list that you people who live with autism parents can go and put their child on that list. So with the address, and so the police force will know that if they have someone who is disorganized and they have an issue with someone with having
a disability,
because sometimes they're in crisis, and so they will know that when they go to that person, they know that it's not about some person that it's really doing a bad thing. It's about autism, and
they know how to interact with them.
Yeah, exactly, and how to intervene, and so that's really important. And also, there are cinemas in Laval that are doing special sessions for people that live with the autism spectrum, so they can go and watch a movie, and it doesn't matter if they make noise or if they get up or if they shout or so. And they did that, and they're also music concerts also are not that. So to integrate those children, to have the idea of say, well, no, we gotta set programs to integrate people living with the autism spectrum in the workforce. It's really, really important because it makes it a transition from the school system to the workforce, and they also for their self-esteem. It's really important because a lot of them, well, most of them are conscious of their differences, and it's troubling to live with that. And a lot of them will say, well, why can't I do something? Why can't I be with my peers anymore? So it's a really big step that Laval is doing, and there are a couple of American cities that are doing these types of programs. Mr. Randy Lewis does it in the private sector. And so I really salute this initiative from the Ville of Laval, from the city of Laval. All sorts of challenges that come up. When they're really small, they're different. But then you get to say, well, okay, well, I guess I won't have the hockey games, and we won't have the friend coming to sleepovers, and the anguish of all parents that have a child who has the autism spectrum is, well, the first one, the biggest of all, is what is going to happen when I'm not going to be there anymore. So you try to expect the best and you try to plan the worst.
How can I help?
I think to have those, to set up those programs is really good for your image in society. First of all, yeah, it's maybe shallow to say that, but I think it is important. And then I think that your employees will actually appreciate it, because it means that you work for a company that have this conscience about what society should be, what civilized world should be. That a great society, great companies take care of their elderly and the education of their population and health. So I think if a company has this conscience about taking care of as much as they can of society and of people that are different but still can give something, I think that it's a win-win situation. It's not just about giving. The company will receive, will get back. Yeah.
That's amazing. Thank you so much, and have a great conference, and thank you for being available to us.
You're welcome, and it's Autism Month, so wear blue. Blue is the color of autism.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Today we have a great show for you guys. We just came back from we're fired up actually, because it was a very important
exciting
conference.
And I have to say also historic. It's over a year and a half in the making, and finally we saw the end result today. Well, not the end, the start, but the results of a year and a half of work and being involved in this initiative.
Absolutely, employing people with autism.
And my first question, it's got to go to Mr. Katilufos. Can you explain to us the initiative going back a year and a half ago, all the way to today? Mm-hmm. What steps did you have to take, that idea that was born and add giant steps and bring it to fruition today?
Well, originally the idea actually came out of a conference that we organized at Giant Steps with an organization called Autism in Motion. We had a roundtable discussion, and among the many issues that came up was the fact that many people with autism just can't get work. They're not employable for many reasons, or at least that's the perception, unfortunately. So from that idea, we began to talk about what it would mean to make a city more inclusive, a municipality, and ultimately deal with the issue of employability. So from that, I wound up approaching Mr. David Dakotis, who, as we know, is the chair, if I'm not mistaken, of the executive committee of the city of Laval.
Yes.
And a very active member, obviously, of the administration here, as well as of the community. He was extremely open to the idea. He brought us into contact directly with the mayor, and then a number of other people began to get involved, yourself included, Luigi, and we put together a committee to organize today, which was a huge success.
Total success. It was great. Mm-hmm. It's just amazing to see everybody, all the panel on the stage. What's the next step, though? This is step one. How do you see the next step?
Well, the issue for us, I think, I mean, keeping in mind that Giant Steps is a school with a specific mandate. I mean, it's there to service its students first and foremost. We also have a resource center at the school that's quite important. It reaches out into the community. Today was important for us because we wanted to get the message out to the business community to make them aware about what autism is, and also to make them understand that it is possible to employ people who might be on the spectrum. So for me, I speak for myself at the moment. I think the hope is that this initiative will spread from Laval to other municipalities, and they'll get the idea to take on similar endeavors. That's the whole point. And as a citizen of Laval, I just want to congratulate the city and the administration for taking on the initiative and listening to this and to this idea and giving it a chance. I think that that speaks volumes about the leadership in our city.
And just to your point, Laval is the first autism-inclusive city in Quebec. Mm-hmm. And based on our research, we're almost certain, perhaps,
in Canada.
I would agree with that. I don't think there's another city yet that's attempting to do something like this. We're at the beginning stages of our project. Obviously, yes. There's a lot of things that have to be done before we can achieve what we want to achieve. But it's definitely a good start.
Excellent.
Mr. Henderson, I know that you were looking at accessibility legislation established on municipal level when it comes to people with disabilities broadly, but obviously it's not reflecting the needs of people with autism. Where are we when it comes to this?
I think it's, you know, as a school with a large population of people on the spectrum at Giant Steps, I mean, we see every day the strengths and potential of our student body. And, you know, our mission is to do everything that we can to make sure that they're as successful as possible and that when they leave us and leave school, they go on to either post-secondary education or to the workforce, depending on their interests and needs. And that's where, unfortunately, we see that there's a lot of obstacles that are encountered. So, you know, often in this at the school level, elementary school and high school, you know, there's enough services and there's been enough kind of time, I guess, for the institutions to kind of adapt and develop services that are appropriate for people on the spectrum. You know, it's more recent, I think, that at the post-secondary level, as well as for employment, that those institutions are starting to realize that there's a new reality in terms of, you know, who the potential workforce is and what that looks like, as well as what some of the options are for including different people, different diverse groups of people into both post-secondary education, vocational training, and the workforce. In terms of you know, policy that's related to accessibility, I mean, universal design policies in general do a good job of trying to account for a universal design, so a design of a society that is inclusive of all people. It is more complex in autism, so it's not just a question of an interpreter or a ramp or, you know, accommodating, so it's a lot more individualized. So it's a bit more complicated working that into policy. But I don't think that policy is necessarily the only thing that needs to happen. You know, I think that a lot can happen, you know, in individual industries, businesses, schools can all do their own work without necessarily having policy established. You know, policy, I don't think in this case will solve all of the problems, actually. I think autism needs to be considered when we are developing those policies at a municipal level, but I don't think it's the only solutions.
Any enterprises, owners can actually step ahead and say, well, you know what, I want to make a difference and let me do something about it, right? Sure. I think that would be ideal.
Right. Mm-hmm.
I think we've seen today there's enough resources for those companies to get something started, and that's accessible because we probably met everybody we could meet in Quebec this afternoon. So.
Yeah, that's it. I mean, there's a variety of services as well that can help for individuals with autism that need a little bit more support, or industry that needs a little bit more support to take those steps. So now I guess the big thing is convincing industry to take the leap.
Because it must be heartbreaking for you guys. I mean, you're there, you're with the kids, you're seeing them growing and being those accomplished human beings, mm-hmm. and then at one point you're kind of like, okay, what's next? You know that there's not enough services for them when it comes to employment, aside from the parents, obviously.
And the employment statistics aren't great for people on the autism spectrum. I mean, getting gainful employment and maintaining gainful employment, the statistics across Canada aren't aren't great. They're getting better, but there's still work to be done, for sure.
Awareness is number one priority. Yeah. When you don't know, you cannot solve anything. Mr. Lewis, thank you so much, first, for being here with us. You flew to Canada so that you can give us this amazing conference. You. You're the father of one little boy who's now, 29?
How they grow.
so fast. And he is totally amazing, and you've shown time enough that he can accomplish pretty much whatever he has his mind into.
In his odd, sometimes, way, but certainly.
Nevertheless.
He accomplished a lot more than we would have ever have dreamed.
You know, when I read the article that was written about your work and this conference, the first quote that came to my mind was the one of Albert Einstein, who was an autistic person. And he said that if basically you judge a fish by its abilities of climbing a tree, he's going to grow up to think that he's stupid. So, and when you were in charge of Walgreens, you took your power and you made magic happen. You made people see what you can achieve when you take someone and use them for their proper abilities.
Well, it was kind of two parts. Most people go through life trying to avoid the rocks of here and there, and they don't see the reality that we parents do, is to expose them and to understand the hopes and dreams of a parent and how much a little thing that we could do could have a huge impact on a family in the arc of a life, to expose them to that. And then it was just to open up our minds to perhaps there's a group of people who can do the work, who want to do the work, but could never get through our traditional processes of hiring and firing. For example, looking you in the eye during an interview, we would exclude somebody for that. Or if we asked them the question, why would you like to work here? And they would answer, my son would answer, how would I know? I've never worked here. So those kind of things get in the way. We just opened our eyes to, so they can do the work, so
from
let's
judgment.
Figure out a way, just open the door a little wider. Our friends in Western Canada came up with the idea, well, don't lower the bar on performance, but just open the door a little wider. And that's what it was really about, and it had fantastic results.
You were saying that he went ahead and did his driver's license. He passed it.
First time.
His sister had to do it twice.
I had to do it twice.
So
there you go.
So it's really not. People are just judging because there's a lack of awareness out there on what is autism.
And we make assumptions. We project. And it's taught us over and over again, when we can get past that. Like I say, tell people, a child has every gift to give. The gift my son gave to me was to see past that obvious, and to see a person. And in the process, when we did this on this large scale, it opened up our thinking across the board, even to people without disabilities, and we were confronted with things, and it changed the culture. We'll say much better, being people-centric and making each other successful, and it came like lightning in a bottle.
You accomplished by having the actual facts of the proof that your productivity grew by 40% after employing people that have the autism spectrum. That's huge.
We need to correct that. We had 40% of the people with disabilities. Our productivity was the same, or a little bit better. So it's not, people will ask often, well, people with autism are extra special. They're like Rain Man, or they're all savants. And the question is, does everybody have to be a Jackie Robinson?
Right.
Isn't it okay just to be the same? Just to be the same. So our performance was generally the same for people with disabilities. Safety was better, our retention was better, absentee was less, and the impact on culture and everything we did for a person with autism changed the workplace better for everybody.
Because they're extremely focused.
because they're extremely focused, but it got everybody into trying to make people successful and to look at it when something went wrong. Was this really important, or can we make it better? Can we put signage here? Can we change a policy? It made everybody open and more creative, and that creativity applied to all parts of the business. And that's what got exciting. It wasn't just as good, it was better.
So there's only positives. So we have same or a little bit more in productivity.
Yep.
Absenteeism was reduced.
Yes.
The culture was enriched.
Yes.
And the whole environment of 40% of the workforce in the different logistic plants had some kind of disability.
Yes.
So that's a positive contribution.
That's my testimony.
I know.
It's published.
That's awesome. That's an amazing contribution to the community, to society, and to our children.
Absolutely. And we did it in all 20 centers.
And all the states.
Some had a lot of automation, some that didn't. It wasn't about the automation. It wasn't about the accommodations or the adjustments. It was about the number one indicator of success was the intent to do so.
Just a great job. Randy, Semeline and I, we want to thank you for the initiative you started many years ago in the U.S., but above all, bringing it over to Canada, where we have great contributors that are pushing it, and we're involved also, so we're going to be helping as much as we can to
making this place
up
a little better.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, we all play different instruments in the same orchestra, and it's the music that counts. And it's sweet music.
Thank you.
Gentlemen,
so much.
Thank you so much.
Congratulations again.
Thank
great
you.
Conference.
Thank you.
Mr. Dakotas, as we mentioned before, Laval is the first autism inclusive city in Quebec. And we also have to mention, since we're all from Laval, perhaps the first in Canada. Can you go back and let us know, how did the initiative start when Mr. Katipoulos came and talked to you back in 2015 sometime? And fast forward to today and all the initiative with the different city departments.
Okay, actually, I didn't know Nick Katipoulos before our first telephone call. Nick Katipoulos called me and he said, Mr. Dakotas, my name is Nick Katipoulos. I'd like to talk to you about a personal project that's dear to me. And he said, if you don't mind, when you have time, I know you're very busy, maybe we can get together for a coffee or whatever you're available for. And so we met for a coffee not far from City Hall. And the first thing he told me is, can we put politics aside for a moment? This is a project that's dear to me. And I said, sure, put politics aside. Let's talk about your dear project that's personal to you. And he started talking about autism, that his child is autistic, and that he is with the giant steps. And he said, you know, a city like Laval with its population, it'd be great if we can be an autistic-friendly city. And as Nick was talking, I was already connecting the dots in my head, saying, how can we get this done? Who do I have to speak to? Which doors have to be open on the municipal side with the mayor and so on and so forth? And so after our first conversation, it was about maybe 2 hours, I told Nick, I have all the information I need. Let me get back to you in a few weeks, and we'll take it from there. So I went back, I made some research, and I said, well, an all-inclusive autistic city doesn't exist in the province of Quebec. It probably doesn't even exist in Canada. And so I met with Nick afterwards, a few other meetings to get more information as to what exactly did he expect from the city of Laval. And so he said, a giant step, we can easily and free of charge train all your police officers how to detect autistic children. We can train your firemen when they go for an emergency, how to detect autistic children. We can train your bus drivers. When a child takes the bus, our bus drivers can detect if the child is autistic. Our co-op taxis, when someone takes a taxi, the taxi drivers can also detect autistic children. And so based on that, we scheduled our first meeting with the mayor of Laval, Mac Demers, in January of 2015. Actually, I met Nick in March of 2014. And we met the mayor of Laval in January of 2015. We explained the project, and the mayor says, I believe in this project. The city of Laval will be the first autistic city in Quebec and perhaps in Canada. And everything just to follow through. So Nick Katipoulos and Giant Steps, free of charge. They trained all our police officers, all our firemen, all the bus drivers of the STL and the co-op taxi drivers. And it's a reoccurring training. It's not a one-time deal. So now it's in the curriculum. Whenever a new bus driver comes on board, or a new police officer, or a new fireman, it's part of the training curriculum. And so that's how we got the first phase of this great initiative. But Nikitali Foss wasn't happy. He wants more. So we went back to the drawing board and he says, you know, David, it's great that we have the municipality involved, the city of Laval and the STL, but what about the business community? Because he said, sure, it's great for now when artistic children take the bus or they get stopped by a police officer. That's for now. But what about the future? Artistic children have to have a future in terms of employment. And I said, Nick, what do you have in mind? So he spoke to me about Randy Lewis. And Randy Lewis is the guest speaker that we had in today's Midi Mag. And he said Randy Lewis was the vice chairman of the board of Walgreens, who has an autistic son. And he presented a business case, not a charity case. He presented a business case to the board of directors saying, if we hired autistic children or any other sort of handicap, it's actually good for the bottom line because they're reliable, they're extremely focused, they're task-driven. And it was funny what he said today. It's the only group of people that after the Super Bowl don't call in sick the next day. So they're extremely reliable. And so that's what he had discussed. And that was in January of 2016.
Because it is very scary for the parents to know what's going to happen to my kid once I'm not there anymore.
Exactly. I mean, you want a future for your children to be able to provide for themselves and to have a balanced life, a balanced quality of life. And so that's when the whole notion of Randy Lewis coming in from the United States to give a little conference to the Laval business community. So it was a year
in proven success regarding
success.
Workforce and
yes.
Employing people with autism.
Exactly. It's not only Walgreens, there's SAP Canada that hires a lot of autistic children. And today we had Joloso, which is a Laval-based company that hires autistic children. So it's important for Nikitali Foss and all the parents affected with autistic children that they see that there is a future for the children, there is a business case, and there's a business community that can embrace this type of initiative. And that was the event that we had today with Randy Lewis.
Well, thank you for going ahead with it.
Yeah, Mr. DeCourts, we want to, both Sammy Lynn and I, want to congratulate you, Mr. DeMills, the whole committee, the executive committee, and going with this great initiative, being the first autism inclusive city in Quebec, and again, probably Canada.
And something to be proud of. Yeah,
congratulations, well done.
Thank you.
I'd like to just also thank the Laval Chamber of Commerce that had a great initiative in this project as well. And even Laval families. We have to give credit to Laval families, who was one of the pioneers of this project, for Randy Lewis, who was there during the whole brainstorming session and helped out for this event as well. So big hands of applause to Laval families, who is, as you know, based in Laval. And it really takes at heart the different issues that the different Laval people are living on a day-to-day. So it's thumbs up to Laval families as well.
Mr. DeCourts, it's always a pleasure to have you. Thank you.
It's my pleasure today.
Thank you.
Thank you so
Thank
much.
You. Sammy Lynn, a great show, great conference, great people for autism. April is the month of autism awareness.
Absolutely.
What are your thoughts?
My thoughts is it's all about awareness. Spread the love, people. Make sure that whatever you heard today,
that we share it.
Absolutely, you
we
have
to
share it. You know someone who has an enterprise, you know the facts right now, you're more aware than yesterday, so let's make it happen.
Be part of the awareness. Thank you.